Hello, my friends, and welcome back to Monster Monday. I hope that you are filled with joy because I will be beginning this series by discussing giants. And I've put off this bit for quite some time, but I feel like now is the right time to delve into giants because I fully intend to be using them in some of the upcoming campaigns that you'll see on the channel. So without further ado, let's kick it with the Cloud Giant. So when we're talking about giants, I think about the early AD&D Monster Manual and the depictions of the giants, and some of those pictures were awesome and inspiring, and others were, you know, a little bit silly looking. Like I remember the AD&D fire giant picture just being kind of dumb, like just this big looking like oaf. But cloud giants have always been like kind of majestic and noble. So let's delve into what they look like in 5th edition, and then I'll share some ideas about how you can use them in your adventures. Cloud giants live extravagant lives high above the world, showing little concern for the plights of other races except as amusement. They are muscular with light skin and have hair of silver or blue. Cloud giants are spread to the winds, encompassing vast areas of the world. In times of need, scattered cloud giant families band together as a unified clan. However, they can seldom do so quickly. Attuned to the magic of their airy domains, cloud giants are able to turn into mist and create clouds of billowing fog. They dwell in castles on high mountain peaks or on the solid clouds that once held their fiefs. Still gracing the skies on occasion, these magic clouds are a lasting remnant of the giants' lost empires. Better spellcasters than most other giants, some cloud giants can control weather, bring storms, and steer the wind almost as well as their cousins, the storm giants. Although cloud giants are lower in the ordning than storm giants, the reclusive storm giants rarely engage with the rest of giant kind. As a result, many cloud giants see themselves as having the highest status and power among the giant races. They order lesser giants to seek out wealth and art on their behalf, employing fire giants as smiths and crafters, and using frost giants as reavers, raiders, and plunderers. Dim-witted hill giants serve them as brutes and combat fodder, sometimes fighting for the cloud giants' amusement. A cloud giant might order hill or frost giants to steal from nearby humanoid settlements, which it considers to be a fair tax for its continued beneficence. On their mountain summits and solid clouds, cloud giants keep extraordinary gardens. Grapes as big as apples grow there, along with apples the size of pumpkins and pumpkins the size of wagons. From the errant seeds of these gardens, tales of cottage-sized produce and magic beans are spread in the mortal realm. As humanoid nobles keep an eyrie for hunting hawks, so do cloud giants keep griffins, peritons, and wyverns as their own flying beasts of prey. Such creatures also patrol the cloud giants' gardens by night, along with trained predators such as owlbears and lions. A cloud giant earns its place in the ordning by the treasure it accumulates, the wealth it wears, and the gifts it bestows on other cloud giants. However, value is only one part of the assessment. The extravagance a cloud giant wears or places about its home must also be beautiful or wondrous. Sacks of gold or gems are worth less to a cloud giant than the jewelry that might be crafted from these materials, creating treasures that bring esteem to a cloud giant's household. Rather than steal from one another or fight over treasures, cloud giants are inveterate gamblers with a hunger for high risks and high rewards. They frequently bet on the outcome of events, nominally outside their control, such as the lives of lesser creatures. Ordning ranks and kings' ransoms can be won and lost in bets over the military triumphs of humanoid nations. Fixing wagers by interfering in the conflict causes the loss of the bet, but such deceit is considered to be cheating only if it is discovered. Otherwise, it is cleverness honoring Memnor. So right off the bat, just with that flavorful background and context, cloud giants are really interesting. And I think that, you know, you could look at cloud giants as a random encounter, okay? So just as an encounter, you're looking at something that's going to be like for a high-level group, right? They're traveling through the mountains or through some other high elevation place, and you know they come across this ornate mansion of this, you know, or castle of a cloud giant. And you could certainly have that be a drop-in encounter for a high-level party. And I mean, actually, even for like a veteran, large, mid-level party who really knows what they're doing, you could probably make this work and just scale it down a little bit. But I think that inherent to all of these giants is the opportunity to build an entire adventure around them and maybe even stretch them through a long-term campaign. And here are where my ideas kind of come into this. First of all, they make some references to like a Jack and the Beanstalk sort of thing. So the idea that this cloud giant lives, you know, high up in the clouds, literally in clouds, magical clouds, or in some kind of, you know, cloud-covered mountaintop castle with, you know, beautiful ornate gardens and rare, you know, special fruits and vegetables that grow to be absurd sizes. These are all like great fodder where you can draw inspiration from fairy tales like Jack and the Beanstalk or James and the Giant Peach. For those of you who enjoy the Roald Dahl stories, you know, that's great kind of fairy tale fodder. And if you have a campaign where you kind of have some fey activity already happening with the fairies, that could even tie in really well. Maybe you have an incentive-based kind of adventure set up already. Maybe there's some rare fruit that grows in this cloud giant's garden that is, you know, exceedingly rare and also contains very special magical properties, and its seeds are worth, you know, fortunes to those who know how to use them in the right kind of magic. And thus, you know, a benevolent wizard has reached out to the party of adventurers for their assistance in obtaining one of these rare fruits and bringing it back, and they will be rewarded, right? This could create a great opportunity for the players to flex their ability to kind of infiltrate, sneak in, steal a thing, and get out. Now, this could go in a number of ways. Number one, it could make for a long-term adventure where they have to just getting up to the Cloud Giant's castle could be a series of sessions where they're getting up, or maybe they have the ability of flight and they get up, but once they get up to a certain elevation, they're fighting some of those guardians that were referenced. The flying guardians that, you know, they mention here are great encounters in and of themselves. So, you know, that could be kind of a fun way to have, you know, these creatures like griffins and peritons and wyverns and other flying beasts be, you know, encounters along the way. And then they get up to the castle and, you know, the castle has other defenses, and maybe they discover this giant, you know, has been on his own. He has no family left. And you know, they decide to just straight up murder hobo. They want to go in and get the fruit, but they also want to get the treasure and kill the giant. Okay, fine. Another alternative could be that you could place this giant with his family, and maybe the giant has like a wife and, you know, two kids, and the giant kids are, you know, smaller and scaled down, but they're like children, and, you know, maybe the party is not a bunch of murder hobos and they want to rather kind of negotiate. And maybe in this you have the opportunity for the cloud giant NPC to really shine as, you know, a person who enjoys a little bit of persuasion, a little bit of gambling, and maybe some negotiation on a more social interaction level. And the party then can negotiate for this fruit, but the giant wants something in return. And this could lead to another little side quest or side mission, where now the party's kind of working with this giant in conjunction with what this giant wants, and they will be rewarded with the fruit that they need to get, and then they could take that back to the powerful wizard. So you see, like, when I think of giants, I don't think of them as like just monsters. I think of them as having the potential to be almost any kind of NPC, an ally, a trickster, and you could have like a malevolent, you know, cloud giant. Maybe the cloud giant catches the party And, you know, the party's surrounded by the Cloud Giant and their minions. And the Cloud Giant's like, okay, now we're going to have some fun. You're going to fight in the pit. And they're like, what's the pit? Or maybe you call it the bowl. And you know, the Cloud Giant kicks them all into this bowl. And the minions take their weapons and their clothes and their spell books and all that stuff. And now they have to fight for the giant's entertainment at a banquet of other giants. Not necessarily even against each other. You know, maybe the giant throws like other creatures into this bowl that it's captured or that its minions have brought up for its entertainment. And so now the party kind of becomes embroiled in this gladiatorial kind of entertainment event. And if they perform well, maybe they will please the giant and he will not only grant them their freedom, but he'll give them one of the epic fruits as a gesture of his goodwill. Maybe your party is clever and maybe your party has some giant lore. Or maybe, you know, one of your party members says like, well, what do we know about cloud giants? And what do we know about blah, blah, blah? And you have them make an arcana roll or maybe a history roll, I guess, depending on their approach to this in line of query, this inquiry. And maybe you know, if they have a successful kind of lore check, you can grant them the fact that, you know, some giants, particularly cloud giants, truly enjoy a bit of a gamble. They enjoy gambling. They enjoy contests and stuff. And maybe your party uses that to their advantage in the social interaction, and they somehow make a bet or form an alliance with the cloud giant. So there are a lot of variables that are not just combat for how you can use the cloud giants. Another thing, too, that they mentioned is that cloud giants are adept at magic. And controlling certain things related to the weather. You can use this to your advantage as a DM when describing the setting or creating obstacles. So remember where I said before, you can have a whole adventure series just climbing the mountain and getting through all the different factions that live amongst the mountain and in the mountain and on the mountain and fly around the mountain. But you could also, you know, have a steadfast group who figures out a way to get potions of flying and they just skip past all that. But they still have to get up to kind of the cloud summit, you know, and maybe there are different spells that can make it more challenging for them. So to that end, let's take a look at the stat block, because I think that knowing what the cloud giants can do might help facilitate some ideas for how we can make the lair and the domain of the cloud giant a little more rich. So to begin, these are huge creatures. They're huge giants. And they're described as either being neutral good or neutral evil. Armor class 14, a whole boatload of hit points, 16 d12 plus 96. And the average they have here is 200, but obviously using my typical methods of scaling, you can bump that up if you want to make like an alpha cloud giant, or you can lower that for kind of lesser members of the cloud giants clan who might be in the vicinity. They're considered challenge rating 9, so that's probably pretty appropriate based on what they can do. They have keen smell, so they have advantage on wisdom perception checks that rely on smell. They have innate spell casting, and their ability is charisma. They have a 16 charisma, which is pretty fat. So they have at will detect magic, fog cloud, and light. Then 3 times a day each, they could do feather fall, fly, misty step, and telekinesis. Once a day, they could do control weather or gaseous form. That gives them a lot of options, and it gives you as a DM a lot of different ways to use those magical abilities in a non-combat way, not necessarily combat. You know, whether that's evasion or trickery or kind of obfuscating certain parts of their castle or certain parts of their garden to make things more challenging. And a cloud giant would find those kind of little tricks against the party as being amusing. So it gives you as the DM some license to kind of mess with the party, and not necessarily in a lethal way, but just to kind of make things a little more challenging. So don't forget to use things like that. I mean, especially the fact that they could do fog cloud at will or light at will. All right, now, when it comes to combat, they are not to be scoffed at. They have a multi-attack, so they make 2 Morning Star attacks, and their Morning Stars are big, beefy, giant Morning Stars. They have a plus 12 to hit with a reach of 10 feet, and the damage is 3d8 plus 8. And then they could also throw rocks as a ranged attack. That's also plus 12 to hit with a range of 60 or 240. That's 4d10 plus 8. So actually more damage with the rock attack. Imagine that your party is clever and they figure out a way to fly to the top to the giant's place. Okay, great. Now there's huge boulders flying out at them, right? So maybe you leverage the cloud giant's actual abilities with things like, you know, fog cloud and telekinesis and throwing rocks, you know, as a way of kind of forcing the party to think out other ways to kind of deal with this. And I think even at high level, you know, the fact that cloud giants can be good or evil doesn't necessarily make them just a basic two-dimensional monster. When you're thinking about your cloud giant, think about it in the same fashion that you would build a character. Think about where this cloud giant is in their family. Think about where the cloud giant's family is within the greater cloud giant clan, and also within the ordning, within the order of giants and other giant species. And think about that as it affects the area where you're setting this adventure. Because all of those things should be tied in your mind. You should see story threads connecting maybe the kingdom that exists underneath or to the south of the mountain range, you know, where your players are, the characters come from. Maybe, you know, there's this long history, or maybe there's no history, and maybe, you know, it's just like folklore and like old wives' tales about the giants and the magic beans. But then your party discovers that those are real things, you know, and that there really are giants that live up above the cloud peaks of these mountains. And so you can kind of toy with this even at lower level. Now, oftentimes when I'm talking about monsters, I talk about scaling things and being able to scale things down or up. When you're looking at a cloud giant, there are some options that come to mind. Easily, you could scale cloud giants up very easily by just making their hit points more, you know, making their armor class more, or just literally having a quantity of more cloud giants. Maybe the party has gone up to this castle expecting one cloud giant or one family of cloud giants, but doesn't realize that they've arrived at the same time that they're having a family reunion. And now there are 12 adult cloud giants and a bunch of child cloud giants who are staying for the weekend. And so now it's become more complex because there are more of these. So that can very easily scale for a higher level adventure. But for a lower level adventure, then you're talking about maybe something more like a Jack and the Beanstalk kind of thing where, you know, the party's going to stealth up there and maybe they discover there are no adult cloud giants. Maybe they discover that there's this child, this cloud giant child, who is basically grown up in this castle whose parents were killed by some unknown thing that you can flesh out on your own and have it be part of the story. But basically you have this orphan cloud giant kid who is not mean or malevolent, but just doesn't have any kind of social structure to give them kind of any sort of approach for how to deal with people. And they're not inherently evil, they just don't know any better. They don't have a lot of common sense, as it were. So this is an opportunity where now maybe a mid-level party who would normally get killed facing this cloud giant, you know, a mid-level party with some strategy and some social interaction could get this cloud giant kid to become an ally and to, you know, to provide them with the fruit that they need or whatever it is. Or they could just go full-blown murder hobo and kill this child and loot the riches of this castle that were left by his parents. And then later on, you have cloud giants sending their minions to find this group who killed their nephew, you know? So you could tie these things in from adventure seeds into longer campaign arcs. Furthermore, even if you have whatever adventure go well, you can revisit this thing with the cloud giants then later at higher level coming back to the party and saying, hey, you know, I need you to do me this favor. I will bequeath to you this very awesome magical thing, but there's something that's going on down below in these lower lands that needs to be dealt with, and, you know, I want you to handle this for me. So you could use them like you would an NPC faction leader in your campaign setting as a means of setting up an adventure, as a tie-in to other adventures. Maybe they become allies, and over the course of your campaign, other large creatures threaten or encroach on the cloud giant, on the benevolent, kind cloud giant's castle, or slay some of his family. So a lot of options there. And this is just the tip of the iceberg. But, you know, just going through the book in order, cloud giants are a great resource for adventure seeds. You could just use them as a simple encounter, but I think they warrant consideration for adventures. And as always, I am very interested in hearing if you as a DM have used cloud giants in your games and how that went, or if you as a player have encountered them in games. How did you deal with that? What was that game like? So make sure that you guys share your stories in the comments below, because I enjoy reading all of those. As always, I want to thank you guys for liking and subscribing. Make sure to click that notifications bell, and we'll see you on the next one.
Hello, it's me, Wizzy. I'm back once again to remind you to subscribe and click on the notifications button, and also watch videos that are over there. And then don't forget to tune in to the next episode of whatever show you are just watching, and crafting videos and DM tips and pro tips for vlogging and all sorts of gaming things. And also you could watch Bill eat food and watch other shows featuring Bill. He made me say that because he's a narcissist. Okay, bye.